hearts over with locks of night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior was born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in clothes, lying in a manger." O Lord, Heavenly Father, how we rejoice as we remember the wonderful joy of the birth of Christ. Thank you for the gift of your Son. Thank you for the glorious gospel of peace.
flocks to find a baby in a manger. The prophet Isaiah had foretold the miracle that would happen. He said, "Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel." Every song we sing about his birth celebrates the name that means God with us.
Thank you.
The angel told the shepherds, a Savior has been born for you in David's city. You'll find him wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger. The world desperately needed saving then, and it still does. So the word Savior has moved hearts down through the centuries. In the early 1800s, a priest made it the refrain of a tender carol when he wrote, Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior. Is born.
Thank you.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He's the door, the gate, and the living water, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Lamb of God, and the light of the world, our great high priest and the good shepherd. He's the Word made flesh, and ultimately, King of kings and Lord of lords.
In the bleak midwinter, all creation groans for a world in darkness, frozen like a stone. Light is breaking in a stable far off.
Thank you.
its comfort and healing, glory and majesty. We sing it in praise, and we whisper it in reverence. It's the name we lift up today, and the one we'll worship.
Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. ourselves to be as sinful as we are, and we beg and God, we bow before you and we pray. Accept our praise and accept our hearts and give us mercy and accept us in Christ. For it's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Chapter 2, verse 7. He reminds us that his land is full. In fact, three times he says it's full. He says it's full of gold and silver, an abundance all around. He's full of horses, a defense. He says, but it's full of idols. And we look at our life and we see that God has made us full. Even with all that we have lived through over the years, that God has still made us full. We have plenty, don't we? Even on those times and those days when we have lost things through storm and through flood and through fire, we still have an abundance of things, do we not? And yet at the problem of it all, that God has provided for us of the richness of his grace and mercy, just in the general providence of God, that he does provide for us life and health and strength and food, that we still find ourselves to be horrible creators of idols. R.C. Sproul used to say that it is in man that they are incurably idol makers. We're always constructing idols. We're always putting something ahead of God. And we find ourselves to do that. And maybe at times like Christmas and Easter, when we find a great majority of people do come, and they do find themselves coming to a church service and trying to rectify their life for the other parts of the year. Maybe it's at this time that he calls us to come aside and really to reevaluate things. And though we do like we do when we make all of our resolutions at New Year's, that we have good intentions, that we're going to go on a diet, or that we're going to spend less, or that we're going to save more, that we're going to do whatever it is, more or less, that we find ourselves unable to accomplish the very thing that we had in our heart and set in our heart and plan to do. We find that God calls them. You know, chapters in the Bible are sometimes extremely prevalent because they break us and we break thought and we break speed when we come to a new chapter and sometimes even come to a new verse. But chapter 1 or 41 is very much connected, interlinked, and tied to what has come before it. And so we're reminded that he calls the nations, he calls the islands, he calls coastland, he calls everyone from far and near, and he says, you come, but you be silent. When you come before me, don't come with great conversation, great boasting, great arrogance, with great offerings. Come silently. And as we recall in verse 31, he says, he who waits, the last chapter, I guess I ought to refer. If I say verse 31 and we're in verses 1 to 7, just know ahead of time, if I forget to tell you, it's chapter 40, the one before it. And so in chapter 40, verse 31, he reminded me, he says, they who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. And he says, the islands will renew their strength. What God offers in salvation on one side, we seem to take and twist it and turn it around and use it for something other than that, other than what God's gift is for us. They were to wait upon the Lord, trust in the Lord, because God was going to renew their strength. It reminds them that they will run and not grow weary, and they'll walk and not faint. And you may even have it on a placard someplace in your house, hanging on the wall, to remind you of God's great gift, with an eagle someplace in the background of it all. And he says, the nations do renew their strength. But they renew their strength to come, and to come to approach and to make their defenses. And rather to look and see themselves and evaluate themselves honestly and truly before, that we all together, we're like Psalm 50 tells us, that those who commit adultery and those who steal, they encourage that we pass our lot with them, that we encourage one another in the things and the wrongdoing that we do, that we commend each other. I remember when I was a student at Vincent University, it didn't take long to figure out who were the pot smokers and who weren't. Because the question would go around campus, you'd see people meet, and they'd say, are you cool, man? And it was a slogan, it was a speech, it was a pattern that gave it away, that you knew what they're asking is, are you a pothead? And if they said, yeah, man, I'm cool, then you understood that's what they were saying. There was a certain conversation dialect that united them, and sinners do that, don't they? They ask the questions of themselves, this is what I am, and So we encourage them. They come and they make their defenses. I think the one defense that we all give is, well, to err is to be human, is it not? For us to fail, for us to make mistakes, well, that's just human. We're not perfect, are we? And we give the excuses, do we not? And so they speak their defenses as they come before God, but there will be a day where there'll be no defense, when we finally stand before God and we stand there face to face on that day of judgment, and we are silent. There's nothing that we can say, and though we try to renew our strength so that we try to encourage ourselves that we're in the right and that God's going to accept us, even without Jesus Christ, that God's going to accept us, because really, we weren't really that bad, were we? You know, growing up, I wasn't mean. Although, a couple years ago, at Dad's funeral, one of the young men that went to church with me said, I was always afraid of you. Afraid of me? What were you afraid of me for? I was afraid of you because you seemed like a mean person. Well, I never saw myself as that. And I knew I was a stinker. You know, I was the guy that was always, and I made the excuse that, well, I was just creative, and I was just, you know, I like to have a fun time, and I would do things and take risks, and I knew I was going to get spanked, but it never really bothered me. I never saw myself as what others saw me. Does that make sense? I mean, I even had one at our 40th graduation. I didn't go, because again, that was two summers ago. And at the 40th graduation, they started a Facebook, and they were commenting, and one of the guys goes, you know, you were always mean to me. And I never saw myself as that. You know, I looked in the mirror. I never saw myself as mean. I didn't like fighting. You know, I never did like getting hit. So I didn't really instigate any. But for some reason, other people saw me that way. And it had to be true because one young man from church and one guy from school, they both said the same thing. So can they both be wrong? Yes or no? Yeah, so I wasn't seeing me as I was I? And I think when we come before God, when we come in here, sometimes we don't really see ourselves as who we really are, do we? That we think that everything's fine because I did clean up and I did come. And that really, I'm not the bad person. I don't steal and kill and cheat and all of those things. And I've been faithful to Francis 41 years. I'm not such a bad guy, am I? But God says, be quiet. When you come before me, don't say a word. You encourage yourself to speak, but don't. Don't add sin upon sin. Don't add anything else to it. Because as Isaiah saw when he did see himself in Isaiah chapter 6, he says, I'm a man of unclean lips. And I look around me and I begin to see everybody else as a person of unclean lips. We're all that way. Well, that's no encouragement, is it? I remember that I had a course, maybe Miss Bonnie will appreciate this. And it's trigonometry and calculus to a variable of one. And the whole class failed the first three tests. So we were greatly encouraged. We were all failures. I mean, isn't that how you do it? Well, you know, I don't feel so bad because Joe failed, and Sally failed, and Frank failed, and so did Margaret. You know, we're all failures. So we can all take lead together. We're all failures. We've all come short. We all didn't make the grade. The reality is that there is no defense before God, is there? But we consider Jesus Christ and his humiliation coming, and we look at him, and we begin to argue for our own self-defense, our own self-righteousness, and we see him, and what is there that we can say? He who knew no sin became the sin offering for us. He, in him in whom there was no unrighteousness, in him who not one word was said in vain or in vanity, or even in swearing. And we stand before him and we would all shut our mouths. We will all put our hand over our mouths and we will all have lack of defense. He says in verse 2 something that's very telling, because you see, in fact, it's one of the passages that gives, quote, New Testament scholars trouble. Because he says he is the one who stirs up the one from the east. And he's speaking of Cyrus, and later he will call him by name. And if this is the 7th century prophet, this prophesying, he's prophesying almost 400 years before he is in the war. So how can he call him by name? How can he, is he look ahead and see that there's going to be one named Cyrus that's going to be born and he'll be king of the Persians? Is he a great fourth seer? Is he got a really cool magical ball, crystal ball he can look into and see what's going to happen? Or does he declare from the beginning what the end's going to be? Not looking down the corridors of time, because he's the eternal God that he knows. He's not learning. He's not waiting to read the Port Arthur News to see what happened in the day before. It's not getting that, what was that TV show, Early Edition? The guy who picked up the paper as an early edition, he'd see what's going to happen and try to stop it. He's not getting the early edition. He's not getting the early edition. Look at verse 4. He's the one who calls generations from the beginning. He calls it all before it ever happened. When did God find out that Adam and Eve were going to sin in the garden? Did he come into the garden looking around for them and they're not there? Where did they go? And he finds them hiding around in the bush and they got big leaves on. But what happened today? What's messed up? No. The Bible calls Jesus Christ the Lamb slain when? When? I drive around, one of the things I like to notice because I get construction, that's how I like to watch foundations being poured, being built. Over in Port Nations on the regular main avenue, right there at the corner where Lano comes in, if you're going towards the town, second block, they're putting in a foundation. I mean, they did the dirt work and they come in there and they have put in, they put in a wooden frame. They're digging it out and they put in the plumbing. They've laid it out where the bathroom's going to be and where the kitchen sink's going to be and where the utility room's going to be, and they're laying out the plumbing. And they're going to put sand in there. Once they put the sand in there, they got it all leveled out. They dug in where the piers are going to be. They're going to pour the foundation. They're going to put it in the concrete. Once they pour the concrete, can you change the floor plan? If I put in the plumbing and I got it on the west side of the house, and my wife goes, you know, I really think the bathroom ought to be over on the east side of the house. Once the concrete's poured, can you change it? We're talking about maybe adding some facilities in the ladies' restroom up here. Problem is, the concrete's already poured. And we're going to have to look and see if we can find the plumbing schematic so we can figure out how the lights run so that if we can't possibly, we can bust out concrete and we can put it and move it, add it, and add to it. Once the foundation's poured, the foundation's poured. And God's plan for Jesus Christ coming to this world, the plan for Christmas came before the fall. Before Adam and Eve were even created and made, God had already planned how it was going to be. Pardon me. For some of you, that troubles you. But for me, I find it greatly consoling. Why? Harold, you do your work. They give you a roll of paper before you even go out there. They give you, and it's got the layout of what the land is and elevation. So you've got to come out there and you equip, and you guys get out there and you survey the thing and you figure out how much dirt it's going to take to raise this up and what you're going to have to scrape off in order that you can make it level. You have to figure out what you're going to do to get the elevation so that when you get done with the dirt work, that it's exactly what the plan was. And when I build a house, I get this roll of paper. It had several pages to it. In fact, we see some of that kind of thing in the hallway over here. They're in frames of how this church was built. It is predestined. The builder knows what he's going to do before he starts. I've never built a house without one of those. Somebody sit down and drew, an architect sit down and drew it out. What's it going to look like? He knew before he began what this house is going to look like. And let's just say that I like stucco better than I like brick. And I'm framing this house, and I'm the contractor. I can't come in there and make changes because I think I like it better that way than I like it the way that they drew it up, can I? When the people say, this is what I want, that's what they get. And they're going to fire me because they don't want me to make changes. The only changes can be from the homeowner who owns those blueprints, who bought those blueprints. God went and he called Cyrus from the east. He says, I'm sending one, and he's going to come. The Babylonians may come, and they may conquer you and destroy the place, but I'm sending one that's going to come. And he's going to undo everything that the Babylonians did. When he comes, he's going to have righteousness in his feet. We think about the decree. Jerusalem is destroyed. The temple is destroyed. The wall is destroyed. The people are in a mess. And it becomes a decree that allows the people, the Jews, to return. And they go back to Jerusalem. And they have permission to rebuild the wall. And they get permission that they're able to build the temple. And they're able to go back and have their sacrifices again. It comes from the east. God's plan of restoration, in a sense, Cyrus is like a forerunner to the Messiah that's going to come, that's going to take all of our mistakes and all of our sin and all of our weakness, and he's going to reverse it. He's going to undo it. Everything that Adam lost, Christ is going to give us back. And God planned it. So that in the end, Romans chapter 8 says we've been predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. What are you going to look like on the day that you stand before God? What will you look like? Jesus Christ, our Savior. How's God going to get you there? Well, the plan is God's going to send his Son into this world. He's going to come in the weakness of human flesh. And he's going to be born as a baby. And there's going to be a day when he will be judged and condemned, and he will die. And he will take away all our sins, and he will rise for our justification. And he will ascend into heaven, and he will sit there. And so that when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, and we're adopted in God's family, and we're changed, and everything about us has changed, that one day God will raise us up, and we will sit in God's presence, and we will look like the glory of Jesus Christ. That's the plan. When we go on vacation, and when you go on vacation, you don't go outside and just go whichever the wind blows you. You make a plan, do you not? You plan where you're going to go on a vacation. I know, like with Walter and Patsy, they've taken several vacations with a cousin. They talk about a cruise that they're going to take in Europe or going to Russia. And they got a plan. They say, well, we're going to go to Moscow, St. Petersburg. We're going to go to, I can't think of the other one. And they got a plan. Where are they going to go? What they're going to do when they get there? Do we not make plans? God has a plan. And the plan from the very beginning was this, that Jesus Christ was going to come. And this king, and again, using Cyrus as an example of the Messiah, this king will come with righteousness in his feet. And all the nations will be given to him. And he will subdue them. Christ is coming, and he will subdue all nations and all people. Daniel 7 says that the Son of Man comes before the Ancient of Days, and he gives him every people and tribe and tongue and nation as a reward of his soul. That's what Isaiah 53 says, that it will be the reward. It will be the response of what God gives him for what he did. And he says, so who did this? Who made it happen, verse 4? The one who caused generations from the beginning. The God who knew us before we were born. And what's he saying? He says, I, Yahweh, I am the first, and I am the last. There is no other God. Now, I want you to think about it for just a moment, because we read in the book of Revelation, we read in chapters 4 and 5, what do we find out about Jesus Christ? He's the one who was. He's the one who is. He's the one who's coming. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. What he's saying here of Yahweh God Most High, he's saying of Jesus Christ. So when we think about Jesus Christ, we don't think about a lowly baby in a manger, but we think about an exalted God in heaven. One who exists before time, who created everything. That's what he's already told us. He created everything. There's nothing that exists that he did not bring into existence. So they will see him, be afraid. And the ends of the earth will tremble. But they will draw near, and they will come before him. I think of 1 Peter. When he says, if we call Father, the one who judges people without partiality, he doesn't look at our face. He doesn't look at the outside. on sense. That we come before him in trembling. That there's a sense of awe. We use awesome for a lot of things, but awe means fear. Awesome means fearful. So when we come before God, we know that he's a holy God, as Isaiah said, holy and exalted and lifted up, and all of heaven is full of his glory. And we had a shaking the other night, didn't we? Some people's doors got shook off, some got blown off. There's a shaking going on in heaven in the very presence of God because he's a holy God. And yet, in the midst of all this, in the midst of Christ coming, in the midst of all of his glory, what do we do? One man to his neighbor says, and even to his brother, take courage. Get the engraver. Get him out here making the metal. Beat it out. Get out and beat out the metal with a hammer, the one that strikes on an anvil. You know, one of my favorite things to watch is a forged in fire. Francis bought me an anvil. And I've got some mallets. And I got a really cool vice grip. And I'm waiting to get one of those furnaces. And I'm going to start beating out knives. And use that for a hobby. I'm looking forward to it. And I'm watching to learn and how you do this and what all the mistakes are because I'm watching this. And one man encourages to his other, to the engraver, and the acid stuff that they do on there to put the little designs on it. And he says, he looks at it and he says, it's good. It's tall. It's what God's made it to be. And he fastens it with nails so it does not fall down. And as we saw in the last chapter, what were they doing? They were building idols. Verses 20 and 21. They were building their idols, coating them with gold. Here in the presence of a holy God, how do we still make idols? How do we still adhere to an idol when we see the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ? When we see a God who planned everything from the beginning, that God knows our name. I think we sing that hymn, don't we, John? Don't we, Harold? That he knows my name. If we serve a God who calls us, who makes an announcement, even as a small child with Samuel, who is lying and sleeping, he says, Samuel, Samuel. And he gets up and he runs to Eli and says, what do you want? And he said, go back to sleep. I didn't call you. And he lies down, and a little child, and he hears him again, Samuel, Samuel. He gets up and he comes to Eli. He says, what do you want? He said, I didn't call you. Go back to sleep. A third time he comes, and because he's heard God calling his name. And he says, this must be God. And he says, lie down and sleep. And when you hear his voice, say, here I am, your servant. Speak. Our God calls us by our name. He stirs us out of our slumber, and he calls us to himself, and we draw near to him with no boast of ourselves, but like the hymn says, simply to the cross I cling. We come and we lay hold of Jesus Christ in all of his glory. We receive the forgiveness of sin through his death on the cross, and that's God's plan for each one of us from the very beginning. That we would come to Christ our Savior, that we would call him our Lord and our God, and that we would bow our knee as the one day that we will all bow our knee before him and confess him as Lord, because God has given him a glory that he had before time began. So we sing, oh come, let us adore him. And I invite you to stand with me. And it's my hope and my prayer that as we stand, that in our hearts we cry out, oh God, I adore you. Jesus Christ, I love you. Forgive me of my sins. Let me know you. Let me love you. God, call me. Call me by my name. God, I want to hear your voice.